From 1992 until 2017, the Reverend Barry W. Lynn served as executive director of Americans United for Separation of Church and State. That's a Washington, D.C.-based organization dedicated to the preservation of the Constitution's religious liberty provisions that you find in our First Amendment. Welcome back to the show, Reverend Barry Lynn, who's also a lawyer.
It's wonderful to be back. I had a terrific time last time we got together. And I think in the interim, we were also on someone else's show on XM Sirius. But I don't need
John
to promote
Fugel.
That.
John Fugelsang.
Of course. Yeah. Because we love John.
Yeah.
Yes, no, it's wonderful to be back. And I just hope we don't constantly fall into talking about pornography, which is, as I recall, pretty much all we ended up talking about last time. Because you know, you're really fixated on that issue. You're fixated on it.
I've directed some Christian porn.
Really?
No cursing. There are no curse words, so you can watch it with your family. But I do a little product placement. I have in porn, and I've appeared in pornography.
That's really great.
Yeah.
And these are the things. What, I've known you, what, a year, a little over a year, and I didn't know any of those things about you. And now I do. And so immediately after we finish this, I was going to go watch the next episode of The Man in the High Castle, but maybe I'll just Google you and porn and see what pops up.
My favorite movie, The High Castle and the Man.
So what should we talk about today, David?
Well, Reverend Barry Lynn, you are a lawyer, and you served as executive director of Americans United for Separation of Church and State. George Herbert Walker Bush is in the rotunda. I hope he's dead, because he's underneath an American flag and in a coffin. I hate to think that he's still alive. And it's, you know, sorry to see the guy go. He was a decent man. I think he tried his best, and I don't think it's appropriate at this point to talk about his past. What I did find offensive is the use of the Old Testament. Mike Pence got up and quoted, I think, King David, and then the Speaker of the House talked about what grace is, and I thought, if I were a Muslim, an atheist, or a Jew, which I am, I'm a Muslim, atheist, Jew.
Right.
And I would be offended by that. Is that appropriate for our government leaders to be evoking Judeo-Christian biblical imagery in the Capitol?
It really isn't, but of course this is done all the time. And one of the questions I have, even before we get into specifically what was said, this idea of a state funeral, even for George Herbert Walker Bush, who by all stretches of the imagination was a vastly more decent person than his son or our current president. But I think we should reserve state funerals for people who, like Jack Kennedy, were assassinated and therefore in office. Otherwise, this whole idea, you know, I'm here in Washington. This place is insane now. They're going to close Washington for part of today, for tomorrow, for all of Wednesday.
So they're shutting down Washington, D.C. The stock market is...
The stock market's gone.
It's nice to see a Bush closing a stock market without tanking the economy first.
Yes, it is. This is a rare moment.
Yeah. We don't need to tarnish his image. But I was reading about government salaries. The House of Representatives has a chaplain who gets $180,000 a year.
Yes, he does. And, you know, there was a very brief period when I was doing radio with Pat Buchanan for about a year and a half every afternoon. And we had various of the leadership of the House on a regular basis, and not because they like me, but because they like Pat. And at one point, the second ranking official in the House of Representatives, I said to him, you're trying to cut costs. They were cutting elevator operators, not paying them. I said, why don't you get rid of the chaplain? And then I went out into the community and I got dozens of ministers, imams, rabbis who lived close to the Capitol who said, we would be willing to counsel anyone who needs counseling, and we would do it for nothing. It would be a privilege. And and then, you know, they only give a 1 minute prayer at the beginning of every House of Representatives session. And nobody pays any attention. And in fact, very few people are even on the floor. I think it was Newsweek did a review of the number of people who were there to hear the prayer the same day they voted on the constitutional amendment to bring back government-sponsored prayer to schools, which got a majority but not enough to become part of the Constitution. But there were like 30 people there voluntarily to hear their own prayer the morning of the vote. So nobody in Congress, very few people take religion seriously, but it certainly seems to be something they all feel compelled to talk about, particularly at election time, to prove just how religious they really are. And so, if you believe them, if you, the voter, believe them, shame on you.
Right. The chaplain, $180,000 a year.
Yeah.
That's a lot of money. What does he do? What does he do?
He counsels people occasionally.
The only counseling Congress needs is legal counseling. They don't. They don't. And do we know what denomination he is?
I believe the current pastor is actually a Catholic. The current chaplain. But you know, there's a second chaplain. I mean, you're letting them off easy. The Senate has its own separate chaplain who makes the same amount of money, and both of them have assistants who make about half of their salary. So we're talking about $550,000 devoted to religion. And this does go back a long way in the history of the country, but James Madison, who in many ways was more of a church-state separationist than even Thomas Jefferson, he did vote for a chaplain in the Congress. And later, in what are called his detached memoranda, he said that it was the worst decision he had ever made, because he said, you know, if we had just done this voluntarily and as members of Congress paid for this service out of our own pocket, it would have been a wonderful example for the rest of the country. That was brilliant.
How long do they serve for?
They pretty much serve at the whim of the Speaker of the House. And when we were trying to get rid of them, it was Newt Gingrich who was Speaker of the House. And Newt Gingrich was asked by the New York Times a couple days after I started this whole process trying to get rid of them. And Gingrich said he had thought about it but decided to keep them. When asked why, he said it would look bad if we got rid of them. Now that, what, you know, you think about Newt, who didn't always tell the truth. That was a pretty truthful answer.
I think he's religious. His wife, Callista, is our ambassador to the Vatican. And I believe he met her while she was on her knees.
I can't even comment on that. That's another thing. Why do we have an ambassador? It's actually the ambassador to the Holy See. Mm-hmm. It's not the ambassador to the Vatican City State, although they're pretty much the same. But I was in I didn't have a lot of agreements when I was running around Congress lobbying for various groups with Jesse Helms. But one day in the elevator, I ran into Jesse Helms, and he said, what are you doing here? And I said, well, this is the one time we're going to agree about something, because he, for reasons I think less pure than mine, wanted there to be no appointment of a Vatican ambassador when the spending bill came up. And I agreed with that. I mean, it's ridiculous. We don't have an ambassador to the National Council of Churches. We don't have an ambassador to the American Jewish Committee.
We have an ambassador to religious freedom now. Didn't we just...
Yeah, we do.
Some charlatan.
He is a charlatan. But you know, the very first ambassador was a good friend of mine, Rabbi David Saperstein, who really did care and does care about religious freedom as people like you and I would understand it, a respectful distance between the institutions of government and those of religion. So David served during the Obama administration and then resigned and was replaced by
Brownback
Brownback
from Kansas.
from Kansas, the former, he was a senator. I believe he was also the governor
Oh,
of
yeah.
Kansas.
We should talk about Brownback. First of all, anybody who's an inveterate homophobe like Sam Brownback should not have the name Brownback. That's the first thing.
Course not.
And secondly, this great champion of religious freedom, this great Christian, was the governor of Kansas, where he proceeded to bankrupt the state by lowering taxes. They always call our states the laboratories of democracy. Well,
Yes, they
Kansas
do.
is where they tested supply side economics, and the lab results are in, and supply side economics is a failure. But that doesn't stop people from saying we should cut taxes for the very wealthy
Course not.
because they're being paid by the very wealthy to say that.
Of course, that is exactly the problem. And but you know, being in Washington and working here most of my life, this is a constant piece of the repertoire of not just the religious right, but the secular right too. I mean, every time I see these cranks like Steve Moore, who used to be on the editorial board of the Wall Street Journal and now crops up constantly on CNN, I remember debating him when we
He's an
both
idiot.
got
He's an
here.
idiot. He is
Yeah,
a true idiot.
he is a true idiot, but I go back a long ways. And you know, obviously he's still on CNN and I'm not, so who's an idiot?
Yeah,
I mean,
well.
some of your listeners are probably thinking that, like, who's this guy Lynn? I mean, I don't see him on TV anymore.
Well, I remember Steve Moore. I did some shows that he appeared on. It was just accepted that he was an idiot. And that he was a mouthpiece for the richest 1%, and no matter what evidence you presented to him, he still said cutting taxes for the very wealthy works. So they gave him a job writing editorials for the Wall Street Journal.
Correct.
Hey, yeah. So let's talk about the argument that we're about to have in a second, because you objected to something I said on this show, and I want to get to that in a second, but they always say never meet your heroes. And people who listen to this show know that I always say meet your heroes, don't meet the people you hate. Because I have met the people I hate, and you fall in love with them. Pat Buchanan, speaking of George Herbert Walker Bush, a lot of people
Right.
think the reason George Herbert Walker Bush wasn't reelected is because of Pat Buchanan, his speech at the Republican convention in
Correct.
1992, where he declared that there should be a culture war against Americans. You worked with Pat Buchanan.
Yeah, about a year and a half, I spent 3 hours every afternoon working for Mutual Radio as the co-host of his radio program. Originally, it was called Pat Buchanan and Company, and it had a whole plethora of people on the left: Juan Williams, Chris Matthews, Bob Bekel, and then they all of them were a little found it very difficult to deal with Pat. So I knew his producer, and his producer calls me and says, "Barry, why don't you just come over one day and see how this works out?" So I did, and
Now,
first
he
thing,
was the first guy to call for a wall, I believe.
probably that's probably one of the kinder, gentler things Pat called for. But you know, and of that speech, you know, so many people said and still say, it sounded so much better in the original German. But I wouldn't say, but you know, Pat was, he was an interesting guy. He did have some sense of humor, which occasionally came out. I remember one thing, he's thinking about running for president the first time, And I'm, of course, thinking a large amount of money is going to leave because when he goes, I go. But he was testing out various ideas. And one idea he comes in with one day is he said, you know, there's a county out here in Maryland that's going to do cable television, putting up the pictures of people who are arrested for soliciting for prostitution. I said, Pat, that's the dumbest idea I've ever heard. So he goes, no, let's talk about it. So we talk about it, and it was a rare day. Every single person calling into the show for an hour agreed with me. And they all said, it'll humiliate whole families. What will children do when their dad is pictured as a lover of hookers right on the local cable station? Mm-hmm. So when the whole hour is over, he looks at me and he says, you know, Barry, I think that's not going to be part of my platform.
Then he found out all the calls were coming from David Vitter.
Now, I don't know. I think David, I'm trying to think if David Vitter.
Mayflower Madam.
Around. What?
Mayflower Madam guy.
No, yeah, he was, but I'm just trying to think if he was around at the time that Pat and I were doing that show. I'm not sure. You know, I'm old.
Either way, he was in diapers.
He was in diapers.
Either way, he was either so young he was in diapers, or he was.
You're thinking you're getting him mixed up with the current president, who allegedly has that fetish.
Apparently, David Vitter had it too. Pat Buchanan, brilliant guy, brilliant.
Extremely.
His knowledge of history. I can see why he and Nixon got along in the White House. They knew they know their stuff.
You know, one of the things about Pat, I remember the whole Monica Lewinsky thing broke, and I actually had another job, so I couldn't literally be there every day, and the person who filled in when I wasn't there was Bob Beckel, who ran the not terribly successful campaign of Walter Mondale's. But Bob was on, and I was listening to it. I was on a train, and I was surprised that Pat never talked about the Monica Lewinsky thing. And it had hit that morning. It was huge news everywhere. So when I went in on Tuesday, I said, Pat, why didn't you and Bob talk about Monica Lewinsky? And he looked at me straight faced and he said, you know, Barry, this is a very serious allegation against the President of the United States. And I don't think we should talk about it till we know more about it. Because he had an enormous respect, David, for the office of the president. And he was so much a part of the history of so many presidents that he was brilliant. He could remember events like when I was with Mr. Nixon, and then he'd fill in the blank, you know, when we were in some country that most people couldn't find on a map, and he'd recite from memory the encounter or the words that Nixon used or Reagan used. He was a bright guy. Yeah. And he once said to me, right before he quit and went on to run unsuccessfully for the presidency, he said, you know, Barry, if I get to be the president, I'm going to appoint you as head of the National Endowment for the Arts. Then there was a pregnant pause. And then he said, for the 2 days before I abolish it completely. But he actually got me hooked up with Oliver North, who I also did talk radio with for many years.
A great man who probably has some nice words to say about George Herbert Walker Bush.
I would think he does.
Or knew to keep his mouth shut about George Herbert Walker Bush during his testimony on Contrariate.
Yeah, well, he, you know, I got to know a lot of Ollie's very close friends. And once I said to one of them, you know, what in the world did North actually know? What's the backstory? And the guy said, I don't believe his own wife actually knows the truth of what did or didn't happen. How's that?
Ollie North sold arms to the Iranians to release the hostages, and he used the profits to fund the Contras in direct violation, I believe, of the Boland Amendment, which specifically said Ronald Reagan cannot support the Contras who were trying to overthrow the Sandinistas in Nicaragua.
That's correct.
And return the Somoza regime to Nicaragua. Yeah. That may be the worst scandal of my lifetime.
Correct.
Contragate, well, if you look into the abyss of Contragate, it's all there. More so than the Kennedy assassination. And everybody blinked. Everybody just said, you know what? Let's not go there. This is just, if we open up this can of worms, we're doomed.
I think there was a lot of sense that this was a bipartisan, if this was all true, and I don't dispute what you've just said, and it's just that I don't have any evidence from North himself or his close friends to verify it, but I think what you just said is correct. But there also is complicity by Democrats in that whole messy process, and I think that's one of the reasons they don't like to investigate. They didn't like to investigate it in any detail, and frankly, they should never have hauled North before the House committee and then screwed up basically the prosecution of him in federal court. You know, he was never convicted of anything. He was convicted, convictions overturned, because there was so much grandstanding on the part of Democrats who made these, thought that they were really proud of themselves for that hearing. But it backfired. And even the ACLU came to the defense of North and said that his trial in federal court had been compromised by the information that was given to the House committee, so that there were people who had no idea whether they actually remembered something based on testimony in federal court or whether they saw it on the NBC Nightly News. And it corrupted the process.
There was it Lawrence Walsh? He was the special prosecutor.
Yeah, he was.
So there are two tracks, and one is the special prosecutor, and one is the joint was it a joint committee?
No, I think it was.
I think it was a special committee, because I know that Inouye was on it, so it had to be the Senate.
It had to be the Senate.
Well, it won't be the. That's not the first time the ACLU defended a Nazi. They have a long history of.
Yes, I worked for the ACLU at the time. As a matter of fact, because you know, remember, I told you the last time we've chatted, I never lie. I don't lie by omission either, and I do remember very clearly the ACLU taking on North's defense in that way, making the argument, don't hold this hearing because it's going to corrupt the process. But of course, the Democrats who were in the majority didn't listen to them, and therefore
they sabotaged it.
Who did?
Well, the Democrats sabotaged it.
They did, because they were so interested. You remember, they called his military uniform a costume. Yeah. I mean, that just doesn't sit right with a lot of people. And as a consequence, the whole thing blew up.
Well, he did something. He violated tradition by testifying before the Senate committee wearing his costume. You're not supposed to do that if you're in the military, right? You're supposed to wear, I think you're supposed to wear civvies.
I'm not sure that there's any. It is certainly true that in general, people still on active duty, for example, don't wear their uniforms. But I don't think there's any rule against it. There's nothing in the federal code that prohibits it. It's just a matter. He did what he wanted to do, and he ultimately did very well by himself.
I remember an interview they gave to Arthur Lyman. He was the Wall Street lawyer who advised the Senate subcommittee on Contragate. They were the ones who conducted the investigation. And Lyman, whose son, by the way, is a very successful director, Lyman said, and he was a Democrat, Arthur Lyman, worst comb-over I'd ever seen in my life. He was the Democratic lawyer investigating. Sure. And he said, you know, we could have impeached Reagan, but we all agreed it would have been unseemly to impeach another Republican president right after we forced Nixon to resign. It wouldn't be good for the country. And then he said, plus Reagan was close to some deal on nuclear warheads with Gorbachev, and we didn't want to jeopardize it.
Sure.
So they,
there was a lot of that sentiment, David. There was a lot of that sentiment, not just from Lyman, but from other people in the top ranks of lawyers for the Democratic Party, officially or unofficially. There was a lot of, we cannot go this way. And it's not for the reasons that people say now, well, let's not try to impeach Donald Trump. That's a very different calculus, but this one was just, if there's any validity to the argument, it was, we don't want to put the country through yet another impeachment because look what happened or might have happened, really didn't happen, when Nixon was forced to resign.
Yeah, and we should point out that George Herbert Walker Bush was head of the CIA before he was vice president. And he sat in on a lot of meetings with Oliver North. And one of Bush's assistants when Bush was vice president, I think his name was Craig Fuller. I'd have to look it up. But
yeah, I'm pretty sure it was.
Yeah, that he was meeting with people, you know, Cubans who were meeting with the Contras. And Lawrence Walsh was the special prosecutor.
Yep.
And kept asking the vice president to turn over his diaries. And George Herbert Walker Bush wouldn't turn over his diaries. It got tied up in court. And eventually, Lawrence Walsh had to issue the special prosecutor report. And he specifically said during his press conference, I cannot clear the vice president, or the president, actually. I think by the time they did the report, George Herbert Walker Bush was president. He said, I can't tell you about his involvement because he never turned over all the documents we asked for. And on George Herbert Walker Bush's way out before Clinton became president, he pardoned the people who were still being investigated for Contragate.
That's correct. Well, you know, the pardon power is virtually absolute. You can do it for any reason, for anybody. I know there's a lot of talk about, well, there's actually a Supreme Court case being argued this week about whether you can prosecute someone under both state and federal law for the same circumstances, for the same criminal activity. And there's a whole conspiracy movement, not completely crazy, that says, well, this is a test case for whether Mr. Trump could be prosecuted by the Attorney General in New York as well as by a federal prosecutor. If the federal prosecution goes south, can this be a backup, prosecute him under New York state law? But, you know, I'm not even convinced that the pardon power doesn't extend to state crimes.
I've heard that it doesn't.
Well, that's the consensus view. But in one of my previous lives, I was the chair of something called the Committee Against Registration and the Draft. And as a consequence, I also had worked for years to get an amnesty for war resistors to the Vietnam War. And so I knew a lot about pardon power. And I'm sure that I don't have them right here, but I wrote a lot of memos, that many of which concluded that the pardon power is so absolute that it could encompass state offenses connected to draft resistance. And well, there were some, because there was state trespassing. I mean, sometimes someone would oppose the war and they'd get into a college building and they'd destroy files, and there were state offenses. I thought you could do that. Pardon.
What did Jimmy Carter do?
He gave a pardon to anybody who asked for it. He did it very quickly because the Senate was about to repudiate his intention to do that. But I worked on that very, very long, very hard. It wasn't a huge movement, but there were about 12 people in the country who actually wanted an amnesty or a pardon. And then we worked with Carter's people to make sure that military deserters were also able to expeditiously get out of the service. And I think it was 3 days without any major consequence. So it was a pretty spectacular incident. And it also showed what people like, frankly, even Barack Obama never understood. In those first couple of months of serving as president, you can get away with a heck of a lot because people have short memories. They don't remember this. People didn't vote against Jimmy Carter because, didn't he pardon those war resistors? Nobody even remembered that anymore. It was all about the hostages, all about his leadership. It had nothing to do with these early moments. So when Barack Obama failed to clean up, for example, all the money that was going to churches for their social programs, we had encouraged it. We had written all kinds of executive order drafts. He could have done it in the first couple of weeks. Nobody would have even remembered it, but he didn't. He hemmed, he hawed, he eventually didn't do anything in 8 years. If you don't act quickly and decisively as an incoming president, you lose by default. And Obama did on some of those issues.
Through the mists of time, we remember Jimmy Carter as a bleeding heart liberal. But when he was president, when he ran for president, he was conservative, wasn't he, as far as Democrats go?
He was, but one of the things that we did polling about, we being the 12 people I just mentioned who were interested in the amnesty for war resistors, did a lot of polling, and it was became clear to Carter and to his top staff, you couldn't get the Democratic nomination for president unless you promised to give an amnesty or pardon to war resisters. And Carter never liked it. He never, this was never something that he wanted to do.
Oh.
But politically, this was what he had to do. And I remember the guy who was kind of the mid-level staffer who did much of the work for Carter. Carter said to him once, and he said to me, he said, "You know, I don't want to go too far with this because if I had been asked to go to Vietnam, I would have gone," says Carter. "I would have gone."
Well, he was a submarine lieutenant
Yeah,
or something, right?
but he wasn't in combat in Vietnam. But he would have gone. And I think that's a compelling remembrance that this was not a terribly, I mean, he's much more liberal today than
Right.
he was when he ran for president or when he served his one term as president.
Now, Tip O'Neill was Speaker of the House, and Teddy Kennedy was the heir to the throne in waiting,
Yep.
hated Jimmy Carter, ended up running against him. He primary challenged Carter in 80. Some say that's one of the reasons Carter lost to Reagan. Was Teddy Kennedy, was Tip O'Neill, were the Northern Democrats angry with Jimmy Carter because he wasn't liberal enough?
Well, there was a certain amount of that. I think that, Tip O'Neill, he was the guy who famously said all politics is local, and he and Chris Matthews was his kind of go-to guy is when he was the Speaker of the House, and Chris and I went to law school together
You
at
went to law school
Georgetown.
with Chris Matthews?
Yep. We had
Wow.
some classes together, and but he was, I don't want to brag about this, but I mean, I was really good at manipulating the press at that time. And so I'd get these front page stories about the draft or the amnesty or whatever thing I was working on. And I remember Chris said once to, we were in a seminar together, and he said, "I see you're on the front page of the Post again. O'Neill would benefit from whatever you're doing. Of course, Tip O'Neill could just sneeze and get on the front pages of newspapers.
With that nose, of course
With
he
that
could.
Well, now see, here you go again. Another objection based on someone's appearance.
Well, he had a bulbous, I mean, that nose.
Yeah, well, so did W.C. Fields.
No,
but I don't
Tip
hear
O'Neill.
You insulting him.
I'm not insulting Tip O'Neill. He had a gin blossom bulbous nose.
Yes,
It was prodigious.
It was prodigious.
I mean, it was something to be proud of.
And I'm sure he was.
Yeah.
Since I'm sure this is going to end up in some smut discussion, we know what is said by famous prostitutes about the significance of nose size.
Yes, big nose, yep. Big Jew.
Yeah.
That's what the prostitutes always say. Hey, so let's talk about...
What are we going to talk about?
All right, so I posted something on my show. You objected to it. And,
correct.
And I am kind of repeating something that one of my heroes, George McGovern, Senator George McGovern, who you knew...
Yes, I did.
Minister, correct? George McGovern?
You know, he studied theology, but I'm not sure he was ever an ordained minister. Not sure.
He was a fighter bomber during World War II?
Yes, he was a bomber. Yes, he was.
But unlike McCain and George Herbert Walker Bush, he didn't get shot down, so he was a Democrat.
Exactly. Because we know the logic of what you've just said is unassailable. If you're not shut down, you're going to become a Democrat.
Yeah.
Of course that makes sense.
Yeah. And Howard Zinn was a bombardier.
Yes, he was.
Over Europe. He dropped napalm.
Yes, he was.
And he came home a more than a Democrat, a strident liberal, because he didn't get shot down.
Mark Hatfield, who was a great hero of mine, and
of course, was a
Republican senator from Oregon, and he was very liberal on everything except abortion, and we just kind of disagreed about that. I'm being pro-choice. He was not. But, he was about to be sent to Japan. I mean, he was ready to be deployed there when the decision was made to drop the atomic bomb first in Hiroshima and then on Nagasaki some days later. And Mark wrote a book called Between a Rock and a Hard Place, which kind of defined how he always viewed himself as a person who, on the one hand, knew, because he was very much opposed to the development of nuclear weapons as a senator, but he knew that he might not even be alive if they hadn't dropped the bomb and if he had ended up being in a land invasion of Japan.
Right.
And he became a Republican.
Okay.
A liberal Republican.
I stand corrected. All right, so here's the...
Okay.
Yes, so
go ahead.
I had gone to see George McGovern speak, and he said that not having a draft is a mistake, because what has happened is nobody has any skin in the game anymore. And more importantly, when you have a draft, then the citizens gain a healthy disrespect for authority. That we had a lot of men and women who served during World War II and Korea. They came out of it with a healthy disrespect for the military. They were suspicious of the generals. And that, I believe, George McGovern didn't say this, but the 60s, the opposition to the Vietnam War and the taking to the streets, I believe, was facilitated by the parents of the protesters who served in World War II and knew not to trust these defense secretaries and Johnson and Westmoreland. And I think because we don't have a draft anymore, people have decided that the military is sacred. You don't question a general. They're all good. They're willing to die for their country. We're not, so they're better than we are. It's gotten to the point now where we're talking about Kelly, who's the chief of staff. He's a general. Mattis, who's the Mad Dog Mattis, head of defense. And we're all saying, well, thank God we have these generals, grown-ups, who are keeping an eye on Trump. And I keep thinking, no, that's not the way it's supposed to work. And why should I trust Kelly or Mattis?
Well, you shouldn't trust Kelly or Mattis, but I'm more, and George McGovern and I occasionally talked about this, and I know that I think you're accurately summarizing what he thought, but I'm more of the Senator Mike Gravel, another great Democrat of that era's view when it comes to the draft. Mike Gravel, of course, who released, would have had the Washington Post and New York Times not won that big Supreme Court case allowing them to publish the Pentagon Papers. Gravel had some weeks earlier actually convened one of his little subcommittees, read into the record the beginning of the Pentagon Papers, asked that it be submitted in its entirety to the congressional record. That's the stuff you don't see in the movie, The Post.
Yeah.
But Mike...
from Alaska, so right?
Yeah, and it would have been published anyway because he had the authority. The committee had voted to publish it. And but Mike always says, and he's Mike's still alive, he says, if we had a draft over the last 20 years, think of the wars we would already be involved in, because the draft, or as I prefer to call it, conscription, because it sounds worse and it is worse, conscription means the government doesn't have to convince anybody to support anything because they have an unlimited pool of people these days, men and women, to call up and force them to go into any war that the government thinks is appropriate. And that, to me, overshadows this argument, which I find kind of a little up in the air, a little ethereal, that somehow the American people, if there was a draft, we'd all take this more seriously. So one of the things I've been curious about most of my life, and it changes every 5 years. I don't think you should not know. This is like a gotcha question. Do you know who was the first American killed in Vietnam? No, you wouldn't know that.
Oh, hang on. Who was John Birch? He was killed in China.
Yeah, he had nothing to do with Vietnam.
Okay.
But it was a guy named Richard P. Fitzgibbon, Jr. He died in June of 1956. The first casualty. Remember, officially, we were not even in the war in 1956, but we had advisors who were being sent over, allegedly, to help the South Vietnamese army. And this guy was handing out candy to orphans in Saigon when a fellow member of the Air Force, who is largely referred to now as deranged, a deranged airman, shot Fitzgibbon and killed him. That was 1956, the last combat deaths in Vietnam, not in 1973, which is when the Paris Peace Accords were signed, but in 1975. Two guys in Saigon, killed the same day in April, one day before Saigon was taken over by the North Vietnamese, killed in a rocket attack. That's 19 years of American fatalities. So those of us who may have thought, and I spent a lot of time opposed to the Vietnam War ever since I was in high school, but frankly, you look back at what you did, and it sure as hell took a long time to convince people, including our parents, to do anything about this war. So this idea that the draft somehow it makes everybody vulnerable and then they protest more and their parents protest, I just don't buy it, David.
Well, that's all right. So that's why the war in Afghanistan is over.
Yes, 17 years, it's not over.
Well, that's the point I'm making.
No, I know that, but I think that the idea that it would be different if this was being fought by draftees is erroneous.
Well, here's the difference.
Go ahead.
The difference is we knew what was going on in Vietnam. We paid attention to it. We knew about the POWs, the missing in action. We knew that there was a war going on in Vietnam. It was covered. We don't follow what's going on in Afghanistan. I think something like 250,000 Afghani security forces have died in the past 5 years.
That's correct. It's been enormous death.
And we just lost three soldiers like 4 days ago. Yeah, we don't follow that anymore. And they're doing 14 tours of duty.
Well, they're being paid to do it, though. And that let me just make one point before I talk a little about what the responsibility is.
Excuse me for 1 second, because I think I'm winning this argument. And
really?
Either way, I'm going to...
Stop.
Hang on for 1 second. And I'm going to edit this later?
Sure.
To make sure that I win this argument?
Sure, absolutely.
By the way, can you just say the following words for me? Wrong. Say wrong.
Wrong.
Say, let's get a clear version of that. Wrong.
Wrong. Wrong.
I am.
It's like a pirate thing.
And I
am.
Just, am.
Wrong. Am. What does that mean?
I'm just going to edit that properly.
I
am. But
no, wait. But let me go back to something. This idea that we knew. We didn't know much now. We don't pay attention now. I remind you in 1964 how the United States gave carte blanche to Lyndon Johnson to pursue the Vietnam War. It was called the Gulf of Tonkin Resolution. I remember watching it being debated when I was on vacation with my parents, when I was probably just starting high school. The Gulf of Tonkin Resolution was based on, let's put it this politely, 1.5 fictions. One probably not truthful statement about an attack on an American vessel in the Gulf of Tonkin. And the second, and frankly, it sounded much worse, and it turned out to be a complete lie. We never had two vessels attacked by the North Vietnamese. Never. It was built on a lie, and Robert McNamara, who was the Secretary of Defense, finally, near his own death, writes a book and basically admits that that was the case. It was based on a fiction, similar to what gets us started in the wars in Iran and Afghanistan, which was another lie. When the first Gulf War was fought, according to President Bush, because if we didn't stop them in Kuwait, they would go into Saudi Arabia and take it over. Well, I think more people now than then would have said, so what? Because we know just how corrupt the Saudi government is. But that was a lie. There's no evidence that Saddam Hussein had any plans to go in further than Kuwait. So whether you have an all-volunteer force or you have a draft.
What about the incubators?
People lie.
What about the incubators? They were stealing all the incubators out of Kuwait.
Yeah, they were.
No, they weren't. That was a lie.
Of course. But everything is built on a lie, David. So do you want a lying government, Democrat or Republican, to be able to conscript people to go fight these wars, or do you actually want to make it necessary to prove that you have a case to make so that you can enlist people voluntarily to serve? And by the way, if you volunteer and you get paid more, which is fair, because I think if you do dangerous work, you ought to be paid to do it. And that's what the all-volunteer force has permitted, an increase in pay to do what is admittedly dangerous work.
Well, I think when you have war, and war should be the last option, when we go to war, we should have witnesses. I worry that our soldiers right now are not witnessing what's going on. It's not in their best interests to blow the whistle and report their superiors. So by sending people to war by force, you got to be sending them into war for a good reason. Otherwise, they're going to resist and they're going to put up a fight. Now, I agree with you. You're right that the first American was killed in 56 and the last American was killed in what, 75? In Vietnam. So that's 21 years in Vietnam.
Yep.
But the Gulf of Tonkin was 64.
Yep.
By 67, the anti-war movement was in full bloom. And by the election of 68, the war in Vietnam was the issue. That's what people were voting on.
And who got elected? Who was elected in 1968?
It was Nixon. It was close. Yeah. And he promised, he ran on a promise to end the war, that he said, I have a plan. I'm not going to reveal it. I have a secret plan to end this war. So within 4 years, the escalation in Vietnam started in 65. I guess it peaked in 67, right? With half a
by 68, yeah.
So by, well, the number of troops in Vietnam, I think, peaked in 67, maybe 68. Yeah. And so, because the draft was still in effect, that was the campaign of 68. That was what the election was about. And both candidates promised to end the war.
That's correct. But it goes to show you that when presented with the evidence from each candidate about what they would do or what they would say they would do, it would make me feel better to think that, you know, marching with Dr. King the day in New York City where he mixed his statements about inequality of income with his opposition to the war in Vietnam and all the organizing I did and all of that, that it made a huge difference. But frankly, I don't think the history books will be able to prove that.
Well, I'm going to let you win this argument. I'll tell you why.
Okay.
We invaded Iraq in 2003. In March of 2003.
Yep.
By May of 2003, Valerie Plame's husband, Joe Wilson, had written the op-ed article for the New York Times saying there was no yellow cake. Yep. That was 2003. By 2004, Howard Dean was the front runner, and his claim to fame was he was against the war.
Sure.
From before the war even started. And John Kerry, the nominee, the Democratic nominee, in 2004, ran to end the war in Iraq. So you won the argument because within one year, with no draft, 1 year into the war, the Democrats had an anti-war candidate by the name of John Kerry. So you're
right. That's correct.
You're right.
Okay, so I win.
You win.
Is there some kind of prize that I get?
Yeah, you get a prize. Yeah.
What is it?
You have to come back.
Okay.
That's if you lose.
Oh, yeah.
No, I love doing
this.
All right, you won the argument. You won the argument. By the way, you said that this would end with porn, and it will.
Yes. How?
One of my ideas is liberal porn, and everybody has their clothes on.
Yeah.
But you watch what just happened. Somebody actually admitting they're wrong in an argument. I think that is the ultimate pornography.
Oh, man. we should be filming this.
Didn't you?
Because this isn't going to, it's not porn. I think you might still dial a porn. You can just call up and get recorded pornography on the telephone. But normally you watch it. It's very visual. And we don't have this visualize.
No, I think this is very erotic for a lot of people.
No kidding.
I really believe that this is a turn on. I think it's a turn on for women. I really do believe that a lot of women are getting off on the idea that I'm saying to you, you know what? You're right. You're right. I'm wrong.
Oh, man.
You know what? Thank you. Hang on. Hang on. Let these women finish because they're in mid-orgasm. So hang on, Reverend Barry.
Okay.
Let me just finish them off.
Please.
Reverend Barry, Lynn, you are right, and I am wrong. I didn't realize how wrong I was about the draft until you explained to me all the important points, and I thank you for that, and I will now think otherwise. Thank
May I close with a quote from a person that would have been a mutual friend?
I'm going to light up a cigarette. Hang on for one
minute. Please light up a cigarette.
Was it as good for you as it was for me?
Absolutely.
Okay. Go ahead.
Daniel Webster in 1814 said something which I used to quote all the time, and I recovered it just yesterday.
Daniel Webster, this was the guy from the sitcom with Alex Karras?
Yeah, this was Daniel Webster, famous historical figure.
Oh.
He said, "Where is it written in the Constitution that you may take children from their parents or parents from their children and compel them to fight the battles in any war in which the folly or the wickedness of government may engage it?"
Okay.
And the answer is nowhere.
All right.
Is it written?
How about this then? I agree with you. You won the argument.
Yeah. Okay.
Next week, let's argue about stolen valor. I'm for stolen valor. I think there are a lot of guys like me who, you know, wanted to serve in Vietnam, but like Dick Cheney, they had other priorities.
Sure.
I was too young at the time to serve in Vietnam. I would have gone to Vietnam if I could be guaranteed that I'd come home safely.
Right.
And, you know, I think I'm entitled to a little stolen valor.
You know, I think that's a commendable argument, and I'm not sure I'd want to take the opposing viewpoint, but it's I hope you didn't just learn this from our president, who remarkably always, although he does admit those bone spurs that kept him three times, I think, out of the military, and have now apparently disappeared. That he would have gone, just like he would have gone into those schools where there were shooting, guns blazing. He would have done it had he been there.
Right. I was thinking more of Senator Richard Blumenthal from Connecticut. The great Democrat.
Yeah.
The great Democrat who, you know, said he would have served in Vietnam and said he did serve in Vietnam, but then he... Turns out he didn't serve in Vietnam, but he would have if he could have, but he didn't. And forgive and forget. That's what I'm saying, is amnesty for stolen valor.
It's a wonderful point that you make. And I have always said there was a guy I had reason to just read something of him, and I've already forgotten. It's late on the East Coast here. It's late. He wrote an article about why he was upset. He should have gone to Vietnam. And I remember writing this guy a letter. He writes for The Atlantic. And I said, well, let me tell you something. I didn't go. And there's never one second that I wish I had. But I had my own kind of response to this. After I got, in no small measure because of the work that the 12 people I mentioned an hour ago did to get amnesty, I spent time with Senator Jim Abaresque, Democrat of South Dakota, Senator Ed Brooke, Republican of Massachusetts.
Who dated Elizabeth Taylor.
He may have. I didn't know him at the time. I didn't know Elizabeth Taylor ever, so I don't know if they were dating. But if you say so.
He was African-American, correct?
Yes, he was. But the two of them worked assiduously every day with me to clean up the military discharge system for Vietnam veterans, because during the Vietnam War, one of the other great crimes was if you were acting up in any way, your commanding officer would come to you and say, "Now listen, David, we got a problem. I know you've been smoking dope, but we got a solution too. We could court-martial you. You could end up in prison for 5 years, or we could just give you an administrative discharge, which would mean it would get you out in 3 or 4 days. Now, you will have an undesirable discharge, which actually sounds really terrible from a medical perspective as well as a legal one. And people just, they had no lawyers, and they would take it because they didn't want to be court-martialed. And then they'd get out, and they could never get a job, and they could never get VA benefits. And to their credit, Aberesk and Ed Brook got even Bob Dole to agree to change that military discharge system. So there were a lot of people who went, who fought, who maybe did something minor, got a little screwed up, and were about to face penalties for the rest of their lives. But thanks to the Abresk and Ed Brook activity, ultimately were able to get those discharges changed, get their VA benefits, and go on with their life. And I think that's the responsibility. The people who honestly say, "Oh, I wish I had been to Vietnam," maybe we ought to think about doing something for the people who did go and who are still, at this time, shafted by that experience, whether they liked it, hated it, but there's still a lot of healing to go through for Vietnam veterans and the veterans of Afghanistan and Iraq. End of sermonette.
Were you saying something? I was.
Yeah, you were saying.
No.
You were doing. No, but.
No, I agree with you, Andrew. I can't. Yes, of course.
Yeah, of course. A second point of agreement. If we could find a third thing to agree on, it would be like a trifecta of agreement. And then people would go, "Lynn, David said he's a minister. What? How does he know what a trifecta is?" And they'd say, "I wonder if he spends time at the racetrack." And I would say, "No, I just read those Dick Francis mystery novels."
Is trifecta a religious term?
No, it's a sports term. It's a betting term. It's a betting term. It's a term you use at the racetrack.
What about Father, Son, and Holy Ghost? Isn't that a trifecta?
Yeah, it is a trifecta, but very few people know that. And but it is the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. That's what we Protestants call it, Holy Spirit.
And it's all one, right?
Yeah, of course it's all one. You know, we're going to have to talk theology sometime.
Okay. Listen.
Clear this up.
I got to find a religion that works for me, because this Jew thing?
Yeah.
No upside. I keep waiting for the upside. You know, maybe it's because whenever I'm in temple, I end all my prayers with, "And make it snappy. You hear me, God? Make it snappy. I don't have all day." All right. Well, let me wrap this up by thanking you. This
Absolutely.
did not go well. It was not fun. We accomplished nothing. It was a complete waste of art. No, this was great. The Reverend, why did they say the Reverend?
Because that is the accurate way to, in other words, you should never write, if let's say you were writing me a letter, you should address it to the Reverend Barry Lynn, not Reverend Barry Lynn.
Okay.
It's just a mention of art. It's a form of art.
Now, can I call you
of art?
Can I call you the for short?
Yeah, just call me the.
Hey, the.
T-H-E. Remember that old TV series? T-H-E, cat. It was about a woman detective. T-H-E, cat. I don't know what the T-H-E stood for.
Well.
And you don't even remember the show because you were in. Be probably in diapers.
Yes, with the Mayflower Madam waiting for
exactly
for David Vitter to finish up. Senator David Vitter, for our kids who are listening, David Vitter was the senator from Louisiana, and apparently, allegedly, people say that he liked to wear diapers while doing business with the Mayflower Madam. He did his own business. And okay, the Reverend Barry W. Lynn served as executive director of Americans United for Separation of Church and State, a Washington, D.C.-based organization dedicated to the preservation of the Constitution's religious liberty provisions. He did this from 1992 until 2017. And Reverend Barry Lynn is both a reverend and a lawyer.
I enjoy this show very much. I enjoy being a guest on it. I enjoy listening to it, even when I'm not a guest on it. So I hope you keep doing this, and I hope you keep inviting me back, even if occasionally maybe I beat you in an argument.
Here's how I wrap up every interview. I wish I had it in my power to forgive you. Stay on the line for one second.
Sure.